Hey guys, how's it going? So, I was going to record another video today about the negative thoughts we get while posting on social media and my advice to combat them. But I am looking for more input from you guys on it, so I will link my tweet below and you could give me your answer. The higher the response, the better. I will be able to draw out a consensus of thoughts. Also, please follow me on Twitch. I'm streaming my art process every Monday and Tuesday, 11:30 PM IST. Today I'm going to do something different. I'm going to talk about writing. I write as a hobby and don't like calling myself a writer. It's not because I don't feel good about my work, but just because I don't want it to become something that I micromanage like I do with everything else. I want that hobby to just take care of itself. Anyways, a while back I wrote a book on my Wattpad titled Writing Advice from a Reader. I feel like there are many advice columns from fellow writers telling you expert opinions, tips and tricks, but very few people are asking what the readers want. So I will be talking a few points from the book, giving you my perspective as a reader. These opinions are based on reading a little too many Wattpad fanfics and a few books available on there. So let's go! Number 1. Frequent POV shifts. Choosing a POV or point of view for your story can be tricky. First person POV is hard to implement perfectly and therefore is often discouraged. Although if you ask me if you can do it, then go for it by all means. And a third person POV is very easy to write but often takes away some of the mystery from the story. Also, often a story looks really static when written in one single POV. Therefore, POV shifts exist. They give the story a dynamic feel. But this is where the problem arises. It appears that a lot of times people often forget or aren't aware of the purpose of POV shifts. The true purpose of POV shift should be to give us a glimpse into another character's mind, to see things from their eyes. We are made aware of the character's opinion on our protagonist's action. For example, a boy continues to glance at his crush occasionally. Does the girl notice? What does she think of it? Is she worried of it? Or is she happy because she likes him back too? The boy cannot know what is going on in her mind, and therefore the reader who is reading from the perspective of the boy may not know the reaction of this action. This is where we need a POV shift into the girl's mind. But if the boy sees that the girl is looking back at him and smiling, we can fairly assume that she not only notices his glances but is also enjoying the attention. In this case, we do not need a POV shift as we can summarize her reaction based on her actions. What I am trying to show from this above example is that every time you want to make a POV shift, ask yourself, is this really called for? Because if you mindlessly keep changing the POV about 10 times in a single chapter, the reader does not get time to settle in any of the character's head and therefore ends up getting confused. One moment, the reader is watching the girl through the protagonist's eyes, and the next moment, they're jerked away from that mindset and thrown into the girl's mind, and now they're smiling at the boy. This kind of haphazard teleporting from one character's mind to another doesn't allow the reader to connect to any of the characters, and they end up feeling like there's a storm going on in their mind, where every character is just flying around only to stay with them for a moment or two. Therefore, don't change your POVs unless they are absolutely necessary. If you absolutely must change your POVs, try to spread them apart. Don't use 4 or 5 POV shifts in one chapter. Even them out, maybe even schedule them. A good way to both even it out and schedule it is to alternate the POVs between chapter. So, if chapter 1 is in the boy's POV, chapter 2 could be in the girl's POV. That way, reader will know what to expect. They are prepared for it. You can do this with 3 or 4 characters as well. As long as you are sure it is absolutely necessary and that you can manage to write them all and schedule them without making it messy. Number 2. Author's notes. Now, this doesn't happen as frequently, but when it does, it completely disrupts the flow of the chapter. The thing I'm talking about is mid-chapter author's notes. Every once in a while, I'd be reading a story that's fun and enjoyable and I'm totally picturing everything happening in my mind. But just then, there'd be an author note in the middle of the chapter talking about something which is, more often than not, pretty trivial. For example, the boy took the girl's hand in his and turned on the music using his other hand. The melodious notes of Maroon 5's latest song echoed through the room. And I love Maroon 5 so much, they are the best. Who agrees? One moment the readers are picturing a boy and a girl about to dance together. The atmosphere is soft and mellow and the readers are anticipating their next move. But the next moment the writer, almost as if tearing through that scene, jumps up and talks about how much they love Maroon 5. It's like, how would you feel if you were watching your favorite movie and during an amazing scene, the director suddenly popped up on the screen and started talking about how much they loved filming in a particular location. I know, director commentaries exist, but we have an option to turn that on or off. There is a particular place to discuss facts and trivias, and in the middle of the chapter is not it. That is not to say you shouldn't tell people what you think and about a particular moment, or what songs do you like, or what part of the story you enjoyed writing. By all means, interact with your readers. In fact, it will be better if you do, so readers can feel more connected to the author instead of thinking of them as a story vending machine. But you must do it in a way that does not diminish the reading experience. You can write ANs before and after the chapters. If a particular word or sentence needs translating or explaining, you can put an asterisk next to it and add the meaning to a footnote. Fortunately, Wattpad also has a really neat system called inline comments, which is available in the app as well as the desktop site. You can mark the paragraph you want to say something about and add an inline comment next to it. That way, the reader will know that the author has left a little note at this point in the story and they can choose to stop and read it or come back after they are done with the chapter. Number 3. Introducing your character. Now, usually, a lot of people begin their stories with a new day beginning in their character's life, because we often associate mornings with beginnings. Mornings are the foundations of our day, so much so that if something bad happens in the morning, it may end up affecting our entire day and productivity. But this does not have to translate into your stories. Your story does not have to begin at the beginning of the day, unless it's relevant to the story. If your main story concerns with the events of lunchtime at a cafeteria, you do not have to describe what toothpaste your character used to brush their teeth with and what color underwear they put on. You can directly begin at lunchtime. And if you are one of those people who can walk readers through their character's morning routine in a way to make them either relatable or to give time for us to get to know them, let me tell you, neither of this works. A character is not going to feel relatable or just your average girl or boy just because their morning routine is so much simple. Because guess what? At least 99.9% of people have the same morning routine. And if you are using it to describe their appearance and taste in clothes, and by the way, this should be a whole another point. But in short, it's boring. It's a boring way to make your readers know your character and a boring way to begin the story. The reader does not need a Pokédex entry of your character. You need to describe their features in a way that is interesting, and this should be spread across the story, not crammed up in the very first paragraph. So unless you can think up an interesting way to begin your story, don't start writing it just yet. Some alternate ways you can begin your stories. Now, I will be using examples from my own stories. Number 1. A different time of the day. The afternoon sun shone brightly in the sky with all its fury, but the young prince was unaffected by it. Number 2. Mid-action. The next moment, the still air was stirred like a jet ski making way through the ocean as someone dashed through the narrow streets, taking swift and precise turns. Panting of breath could be heard clearly due to the stillness of the atmosphere as a brunette made her way through the empty sidewalks, her black blazer flowing behind her like a superhero's cape. Now, this isn't the very first line, but it is part of the opening para and the first glimpse of the character. Number 3. With a dialogue. So, I came to take the throne. So, you know, move. Number 4. The description of the surroundings, settings of for your story. The sunbeams pierced through the stained glass windows, spreading a warm hue in the enormous room. Summer breeze filtered through the elegant garden and brought with it a unique amalgamated scent of flowers through the sole open window. Number 5. Something intense, like mid-argument. How could you do this? I don't know how to trust you after this. Basically, the options are endless. You do not have to follow a set of rules when it comes to story openings. As long as it has a valid reason to be that way and is compelling, it is going to make up for a great opening. So toss that alarm clock out and get creative. Now, the last point for now. Visual cues versus written cues. This one goes especially to the anime fix or people who are mostly inspired by anime. Some might argue this isn't necessarily wrong or is an issue, and they might be right, it's just something I feel affects the quality of the story. I'm talking about using animation visual cues as a description in your story. Now animation has a lot of rules. There's 12 main ones, and there's some things that are specific to a specific industry. In anime, it's things like the sweat drop to show annoyance or boredom, or falling off the chair to show ridicule. These are visual cues, and they best convey their respective messages in a visual scenario. Many writers transfer these things into their writing. A person who is a regular watcher of anime and is well versed with these things might be able to understand what is the writer trying to say, but these things would not work if a complete stranger were to read them. This doesn't help the writer grow their vocabulary as well. It's almost like a crutch for the beginner to lean on and take the easy way out. Instead of translating these visual cues directly into your writing, a better practice would be to find alternate words to describe how your character is feeling. For example, instead of saying she sweat dropped, you can say she spoke with annoyance, or she rolled her eyes, or she fist pumped. Yeah, fist pumped is a word now. Instead of writing he fell off the chair, you can write he was shocked, or he gasped, or he exclaimed. These are things that any standard English speaker can interpret, because these are standard gestures taken from real life, and everyone knows what they look like. Unlike the exaggerated for comedy anime gestures. On a somewhat related note, while describing gestures and visual cues, special attention needs to be paid at who is the speaker here. One good example to convey what I mean here is describing blushing. When the speaker is describing themselves blushing, a better approach would be to describe what they're feeling instead of how they look. For example, my heart sped up and I felt like my cheeks heat up. Makes more sense than my cheeks grew pink, because the narrator cannot see how red their own face is unless they are looking in a mirror. Describing someone else's action of blushing would depend more on their color of the cheeks, or if they're fiddling with their fingers or playing with their hair, because those are things the narrator can see. They cannot explain how that other person must be feeling. These tiny things can give your stories a more authentic feel. When things are mirrored after elements we experience in our real world, it gives the reader a more immersive feeling, and it's easy for them to connect to the story. Transfer what you see around yourself into your stories. Look at how sunlight affects the shadows, how different types of clouds look, and what difference do they have with each other. What is the traffic like during times of day, and is the pattern different in small cities compared to big cities, etc. Things like these will make your story seem real. It would be like creating your own world from scratch, which will feel no less real than the world we live in. So these are some of the points that I suggest as a reader that can help you improve your stories. If you want me to do more of this or a part 2 of this video, please let me know in the comments. And I hope these tips are helpful for you. Bye!